So living with your body rather than living in it is kind of a corollary to another quote that I often use, is to work with your body rather than working on it.
And that Hello and welcome to the Weight Free Wellness Podcast. I am Tara Bachlin, the founder of Weight Free Wellness, and today I have some very special news for you. This is the launch day of the newest contributing podcaster to the Weight Free Wellness platform. Her name is Lori Rose. Lori is a professor of biology and several other classes at Hill College. She's actually the creator of the Wellness Pathway Program, which teaches people how to become wellness coaches, nutritionists, and also herbalists, and integrate that into their current practice or to how to create a wellness practice of their own. So she has lots to share. She gets her podcasting muscles all warmed up here with me in her first interview. It's typical for contributing podcasters to interview me first so they can get used to what it's all about. And I'll tell you what, you'll hear it. Lori is such a natural. We had a blast. She really gets down to the root of what my work is about in body typing through my book, Universal Self-Care, Improved Health Through Self-Understanding. And we also talk about the purpose, the mission, and even the message of weight-free wellness and how that came to me. Again, she's a natural. You'll love her podcast. We have more coming up this week to launch her as the newest contributing podcaster. And also, we have classes coming up online this summer on how to naturally remedy your family with common ailments with natural remedies. And so the first class is how to make your own sunscreen, which first of all, you'll save a lot of money by making your own, and it's super easy. But also she's going to help dispel some myths or questions about, you know, about sunlight and about, you know, do we have to slather on sunscreen all the time? You know, we still need to make vitamin D through getting sun exposure. So what is too much? What's not enough? And also, what about kids, right? I mean, you want to protect their sensitive little skin, but what about, again, the vitamin deficiency issue and how to notice even if there's a vitamin deficiency with vitamin D and supplementing and so forth. So she's going to help us figure out a number of those things. I'm so excited for this. Our first class is free, so just go to weightfreewellness.com and you'll see the banner there to register. And I just want to assure you too that this first class especially, well, it never will be a hard sell program. I'm sure many of you have attended webinars where at the end of they're really pushing hard and buy now, do this now. We are really about providing helpful information, and this information will be available later also for purchase. And so there's no hard sell, but there is a gift of registering early to attend this class for free and also receive the recording afterwards. So if you want to learn how to make your own sunscreen and all the benefits of that, I encourage you to do so. And if you want to know, make sure to learn about future classes. There's great ones coming up, and this is going to be a long intro already, so I'm not going to tell you about every single class that's coming up, but just check it out. So this is a very fun first interview. I had a blast, and I end up watching all these podcasts over again when editing and so forth, and it's just as enjoyable for me the second and third time around, so I'm sure you'll enjoy it as well. Here you go. Have fun. Enjoy.
All right. So hi, everyone. This is Lori Rose with Lori Rose Holistic as a guest podcast contributor with Weight Free Wellness. And I'm actually here with the founder and creator of Weight Free Wellness, Tara Bachlin. How are you?
I'm doing great. So good to be here. I'm excited for this.
Yeah, I'm so excited to be speaking with you and having this conversation with you today. So if you don't mind, can you give our listeners just kind of a background on your education, your goals in life? What's your main mission here on the planet with us?
Well, I'm glad you ended with that point. What's your main mission? Because otherwise we'd be here for a couple hours. But, you know, I think starting off with your last part is probably the easiest place for me to start. And I've known since I was a child that really was here with a mission and as to be of help, be of service, but I really didn't know how I would do that. I thought early on that I might go into the medical field or be a doctor, but what I'm learning actually with a number of people that I interview who have their own healing journey is that when they get into the health and wellness realm, the natural health and wellness realm, that usually it's because they haven't found answers in the allopathic, our traditional, I don't want, okay, I'm not going to say traditional because I get confused, but in our, the modern medical day system that we're accustomed to. And that was certainly the case for me with I want to say severe, but it wasn't like emergency room kind of stuff, but like digestive issues, like irritable bowel type symptoms, celiac disease. And I say symptoms because I was never diagnosed. I mean, as you, I'm sure, are aware too, that 20 some years ago, they weren't readily diagnosing these things, if they even knew about Crohn's disease, celiac disease, IBS. But looking back, I can certainly see that those were some of the conditions I was experiencing, which were, I think, because of my healing journey, were due to eating a lot of wheat. I was around a lot of pesticides. We lived near fields, and so I think there were just a number of things that were just bombarding my body. So through my own journey, I share a lot of that on the podcast already, and but through my own journey, you know, didn't get answers through the medical route, and so it really steered me in the direction of natural health and wellness, and that's where I started really healing my body through detoxing with herbs and proper exercise, and ultimately really learning how to be loving and compassionate with my body. So I think along the way, like many of us in the natural health and healing realm, I'm sure you do have a story like similarly that through your own journey called the healer's journey. So in order to be someone who's sharing the healing message, you have to go through those dark days and dark nights yourself so you can be there and be for and understand really, truly compassionately and sympathetically for another person as you're guiding them through. So yeah, definitely it's been a life calling, a life mission. It's so funny that it has ended up in the technology realm because for years I fought, did not want to be involved in technology. I'm like, I don't want to be at a computer all day, you know, that kind of thing. But it has been the most liberating way and very rewarding way for me to have contact with people literally around the world and deliver the message and help people all around the world. So that's my quickest version, I think, that I can deliver to answer your question.
Well, awesome. I love that. And the two parts I love the most is I think a lot of us can relate to having that calling of wanting to help people. And when we think, oh, I want to help people, the first thing that comes to our mind is conventional allopathic medicine. That's how you help people in our culture. And so I think a lot of us can relate to that journey and sort of taking the long route to get to holistic healing as a mission, either through a personal healing experience or just our, you know, way that we contribute to the world. And the other part I love is your resistance to technology. And so I share that same thing. I just got my first smartphone last month. So this is... Yeah, I'm like the epitome of the resistance, like the Borg. Resistance is futile between me and technology. So, but like you, it has opened up all sorts of worlds. I'm not the one who thinks that social media is all negative. It's a way to connect people around the whole world, and we've learned so much both through Eastern and Western healing modalities and then connecting like-minded people. I think technology has really been crucial on our planet, and it really all just depends on the way you use it.
Mm-hmm. Totally.
So one thing I love about your podcast is the name of it, Weight Free Wellness. So what does that, how'd you come up with that name, and what does that mean to you? What's the mission around that title?
That's a really good question, because in the years that I knew that I was meant to do something that really helps people more so connect with the natural healing realm, I struggled to grasp what this was going to be. And you could say it's kind of like being a picky eater. Like, you know you're hungry, but it has to be just right.
Yeah.
And so I think for some reason, I was just a really picky eater, so to speak, when it came to choosing a name, choosing the really following the calling. But I think a lot of it was because I was really in tune with what it had to be. And so the name actually came to me, and that's just how it had to be. I really tried for years to come up with, and actually I came up with a number of things, which I learned along the way was a process that I needed to go through in order to be able to do what I can do now. So they were the practice projects. And so Weight Free Wellness came to me almost 2 years ago. And, it was one of those things, like I've gotten many names, but then you have to, business-wise, you have to check, okay, is the domain available? Is that this name available? Is it being used here or there? And what I loved about the name is, so you can prompt an idea. It's a really creative process. It's kind of like, I think many creatives could probably relate to this too. Like you can prompt something creatively, but then you have to let go. So my prompt was, okay, business-wise, from what I was studying, it has to have certain terminology. So people, it makes sense. People can grasp onto it, especially like wellness, right? But weight has, for me, and this is part of my journey, that so many of us have struggles with weight. And so I wanted to use the term, but I didn't want to use the term. And so it was beautiful when I kind of put it out there to say, okay, I need something that's going to get people's attention, but also send a message. And the message is it's weight free. So I may have stories of people who have successful weight loss. It's more about mentality. It's teaching that there's more than going on a certain diet or doing a certain exercise routine, that it's really the point of Weight Free Wellness is, even if we do talk about weight, which I'm very cautious in how I talk about it, because it's like a trigger word, that it's really deep down, it's about teaching people that weight is not a good indicator of health. If you're overweight, you already know it. You don't need to measure, you don't need to weigh yourself every day. So I say just ditch the scale, you know, look at how to tune into other key indicators of health. So that's one thing, is that while I struggled with for a while whether to even address weight at all, because it's such a common topic, of course we have to address it, but it's more about teaching how to have a healthy mentality around the topic. Just like any other topic in society, that we may need to address violence. We may not like the topic and to talk about it, but to have a healthy society, we need to actually be able to talk about it and get through it and come to some hopefully healthy conclusions, or at least move towards them. And then the other part, weight free, is that I try to make things pretty simple, you know, pretty practical, so that you can take the weight off of your shoulders. That health doesn't have to be complicated. Actually, it's quite simple. We are the ones that complicate it. There's so much on the internet that can make it seem complicated. So my objective is also by bringing people on to share their stories, or professionals, to keep it simple and not too scientific, you know, because really good health is pretty simple.
Yeah, I love both of those points. You can almost see the weight being lifted off of people's shoulders when you make that point to them that health isn't about weight. You can stop focusing on that. You can just focus on how you feel, and you can focus on whole foods, and you see it actually click. Because it's intuitive once you hear it. You're like, oh. And then the weight lifts off their shoulders. Like, I can stop stressing myself out and judging myself about this. And then the other point, that it doesn't have to be so complex. That's another, just like, oh my gosh, I don't have to spend 10 hours a day thinking about what I'm supposed to be eating. If you just eat whole foods, eat some colors. It can really be that simple. And especially at the beginning of a healing journey. So I really love what that name indicates. And I especially appreciate the struggle with knowing, as a practitioner, you need to deal with weight, but you don't really want to deal with weight, especially not the way our culture deals with weight. And that's one of the, so here's Tara's book. It's called You-niversal Self-care, and you can see it on her website. And that's one of the things I love about your story, is that it really wasn't ultimately at the end of your healing journey, right? It wasn't a weight loss story. It was a body love story. And I think once we make that mental shift to that's what the goal of health really is, and that's where it really starts, with learning to love our bodies, then that's when we can move forward. And one of my favorite quotes at the very beginning of the book, you say, is the greater lesson is to live with our body rather than in it. And so I would love for you to expand on that quote now.
Yeah, it's so good to be reminded of these things. I actually reread my book fairly regularly to really tune in. So living with your body rather than living in it is kind of a corollary to another quote that I often use, is to work with your body rather than working on it. Mm-hmm. And that is that it's like you're... So many of us live disjointed with our bodies and ourselves. We have our mental self, and then we seem to have our body. And our mental self wants to work on our body and make things happen, whether that's going for a run or making it be a certain size, or you're trying to challenge yourself to be a certain way. And through my own experience, and it stems from, first of all, having these troublesome digestive issues, but also going through anorexia and understanding that that was like the epitome for me of understanding this separation of the mental self and the physical self and trying to force things to happen. And that ultimately that is not healthy. I mean, we could relate that in the psychology realm. We could relate that in yoga, which yoga actually means to... it comes from the root word yoke, to join, and that in cross cultures in so many ways, true health is actually about joining ourselves and not being disjointed. And so working with yourself, not on yourself, being with your body, not just in your body, is being a whole human being, so that you can live fully and completely, and rather than just being an automaton whose brain, your brain is telling you and society is to tell you to do one thing, and your body is just going through the motions. And in my experience and observing and working with others, you can live more fully and healthily overall.
Yeah, and I think that's one of the most important contributions from the East to the West, is this mind shift that you have to have the mental healing in order to have the physical healing. Over here, it's like you have your heart, you have your stomach, and you have your spleen, and they're not interconnected, when really it's all interconnected, not just physically, but mentally and emotionally. And something, another quote I really love, and I just underlined it and starred it, and it, you said, I believe that healing can and does happen in an instant. So what did you mean by that? Because it's kind of along these same concepts of mind connecting to body.
Yeah. So what I mean by healing can happen in an instant is that it's more often than not, and we can see this in quantum physics as well, that it's more often than not is actually our mind that needs to change. Our mind affects the energy, our energy body and energetic realm around us. And so when we make this shift, now our bodies are dense material. It's not energy like you can affect and create a radio wave or a microwave relatively simply, or a sound wave. Let's just use that. Okay, so it's easy for me to project my sound. It happens very quickly. So it starts with a thought. That thought is translated in my brain out through my vocal cords. And so you hear the result. I hear the result rather quickly. And very similarly, healing happens. But if we're talking about physical healing, first we have to change our thoughts and our emotion, which translates into our emotions, which then vibrate into our body. But our bodies are more dense entities or bodies of energy. And so, and especially related in the way that we we're used to being on this earth. I'm trying not to get too metaphysical here, but by the way that we're accustomed to seeing healing, we're not used to seeing healing, physical healing happen in an instant. That is still appears to be a miracle to us. So just by programming of our brain, we are used to accepting that, okay, this wound is going to take a week to heal. You know, this broken leg is going to take a month and then recuperation over several months to heal. But when we're talking about, but we can find examples where really miraculous healing happens much faster. So using that analogy that healing happens in an instant, it happens in our mind first, and that's the instant. And the more that we can be practiced at and are faster at translating that thought to change a mentality, to change an emotion, it will happen in our body faster and faster as well. But especially when we do it with love, that's the key component. You have to have this energy. Like, love is the medium. And what I mean by that is that if we were in outer space right now, from what we understand, we wouldn't be able to hear each other if we were talking. Theoretically saying that we could breathe and all that stuff in outer space without suits and everything, theoretically we wouldn't be able to talk to each other because there isn't the medium of air, oxygen, the denseness of the sound to travel between us. Similarly, for healing to happen, the best medium for that is the vibration of love. And so that's why I teach self-love and self-compassion first on your journey to healing, because it creates that medium in which that message, your message, can happen from your brain to your body a lot faster. And incidentally, it actually goes into the outer world a lot faster too. So again, that was a bigger answer than I anticipated, but.
No, I love it. And I think, so addiction recovery is part of my story. And I think what frustrates people around addiction healing is, unless you've ever been through an addiction, with which it can be eating or alcohol or drugs or anything, right? Unless you've ever experienced that feeling, other people on the outside get so frustrated. They don't understand, like, why can't you just stop? Why can't you just stop making your choices that you know are hurting you? And that quote just really connects with why that happens. It's an instant decision, and you can't predict what's going to help someone make that instant decision. And that decision comes with, as you mentioned, the knowledge that physical healing does take a long time. So making that instant decision to embrace that pain and embrace that long healing journey, that's tough, but it is absolutely the first step. And then it explains, you know, the difference between, you can know a zillion things, but actually applying them and doing something with it is a totally different story. And it all starts with that mind shift. And I read in a book, I love the analogy, was that someone, you can be in this completely bad mood, sitting on your couch, thinking the world's falling apart, and then your best friend calls, and in an instant, you go from really, really angry to instantaneously joyful, which just explains that, like, that was an emotional healing right there. That happened instantly. And so it really starts in the mind. And I think that's where modern healthcare kind of misses the boat, because we tell our patients and we tell our clients, take this, do this. And then they leave and there's no emotional healing or mental decision that went with it. And the other thing I wanted to expand on that you brought up is that the way you make that decision does matter. And so here's a quote that I think kind of feeds into the point you were making about making the decision out of love instead of fear. You say, it's critical not to look at unhealthy environments in a fearful way, but rather move towards what supports us. And while that sounds like those two things are not different from each other, can you expand on how those are two very different, subtle, but very different mindsets that make a huge difference in a healing process?
Yeah, it's all about focus. And here, I'm going to use another analogy, not one that I actually grew up with, but it's really a good one some people might really relate to. So my husband's a former racer. And so I've heard this analogy a number of times. It makes total sense. And we can all think of it happening in some area of our life. So as a racer, he says, you know, he rides motorcycle more casually now too, but you always hear people going off the road, right? It's pretty common. And he said, yep, that person was looking at the sign and instead of taking the turn, they just went straight ahead. Or they were looking at the scenery and that's where they went, or they got scared because there was the sign said there's a soft curb or a soft shoulder. And so they're looking at the soft shoulder rather than looking at where they want it to go. And so they ended up going off the shoulder. And it's, even if you don't ride motorcycle, I think we can all think of an example of that in life. And that's what I mean here, that if you're focused on the situation that you're in, something to be cautious about, the soft shoulder, my family has this genetic predisposition to cancer. You know, I'm working in this environment and everybody gets this way or this ailment or something, or just simply I'm working around sick people all the time. I'm going to get the flu. You know, you're already telling your brain that that's going to happen. And there's such a powerful connection between your brain and the body, like I mentioned before. But if you switch it to the other way, which is, no, I'm going to stay on track. This is where I want to go. This is where I'm headed. This is how it's going to happen. You more likely than not are actually going to take that turn correctly. You're going to stay on the path that you want to stay on. And that's the focus. You know, a good example, even just physically, is a couple of years ago, my bestie had a baby, and I was supposed to be there at the birth. They were going to have a home birth, but it didn't work out for because basically the whole family had the flu. And so because of those reasons, you have to go, you know, even the midwife, home birth midwife will say, no, you have to go to the hospital. They all had to have the antibiotics and so forth. And of course, what is normally a pretty stressful, good stress situation was even more stressful. And I was taking care of their 18-month-old at the time at the hospital. Everybody was sick and they're like, you know, you don't have to come. We'll figure something out. And I'm like, no, of course I'm going to be there still, even though I don't get to be at the water birth or whatever. I'm dedicated to be here. And they're like, oh no, you're going to get sick. And I was at their home and sleeping in their bed with their toddler. And I was like, no, everything is going to be fine. This is what we're doing. You focus on what you need to do. I'll take care of this. And I never got sick. I mean, I was up all night and running back and forth and all that stuff. But my dedication, my idea was, I'm not going to get sick because, you know, this is what's happening now. Who knows what they may need in the next coming days. And I think we can all think of a situation like that where it was mind over matter. And so those couple of examples are really what I meant in that statement, that what you focus on and the intention, the feeling you have with that focus, is essentially what you're going to get. And I think we can all think of all kinds of examples that would prove that true.
Absolutely. And I love that visual of just like crashing and burning on the shoulder, because that's what you were staring at. Like, what we focus on, we perpetuate. And even more especially, like, we can make our healthful decisions out of fear and perpetuate that negativity and fear, or we can make those decisions out of positively focused, love-based emotions, and those things will grow and perpetuate. And again, I just feel like that's such an important process that even in the holistic field, we, you know, you'll have practitioners that are just like, okay, here's the food you should eat and here's the herbs you should take. And we just forget that whole, people think of it as woo-woo, right? Woo-woo positive thinking, but we just don't really realize how crucial it is to have that mindset and how really interconnected our thoughts are with the physical manifestation of healing. Because like you keep saying, thoughts become things. And so it starts with your thoughts and what's behind those thoughts in creating a successful healing journey. So I just love that. I could wax philosophical for forever, right? But let's get into some practical advice you have here. So your methodology that you recommend for healing is quite different than conventional modern healing. Again, even in the holistic world, because you have this concept that you've coined called body typing. So give us a little summary on what body typing is and tell our audience, is this a new thing that you just made up or is this something that's tried and true? What is body typing and where did it come from?
So body typing is, I think most of us think of body typing, if you type it into the internet, you'd get like, what's the best clothing for my body type?
Which the hair or the apple shape, right?
Right. Yeah. Right. So in concept, it's actually very similar and just as helpful but in a more expanded way. And so body typing was actually one of the things that really helped me to connect and understand my body more and helped me shift from working on my body to working with my body, because I started to understand, okay, my body does like certain foods better. Okay, my body does function on certain exercise better, and I can actually be in more of a fit state without having to exercise vigorously 5 days a week, that I can actually do less and get more, because that's the way my body operates. And so as I was learning about this, it has origins, very interestingly, it has origins all around the world. And I find this fascinating. And to especially someone who's been trained in the allopathic realm or someone who's just more scientifically based, this can seem very woo-woo, like this is not science, but actually it is science. It's ancient science. And it's been around in varying cultures over 2,000 years. And what's so interesting to me is, like I said, it exists all around the world in times where information traveled as fast as an animal could carry you, mm-hmm. or a ship could carry you. And so it's not like there was the internet and you were just looking it up and like everybody all of a sudden knows about body typing. What that means to me is that it's inherent intuitive knowledge that the ancients discovered and found to be very true, because when you find truths that are cross-cultural, it just adds more likely to their truth and also their similarity. So there's origins all around the world, but some of the better known ones come from Greeks, so the Greek humors, the traditional Chinese medicine elements, which they have five, and then there's Ayurveda, which has the three dosha model, but they also interlace the elements. So, and then our North American Indians culture, Native Americans, also had the four directions, and the different tribes had different variations of this. And again, many more cultures had this in their own forms, but those are probably some of the more well-known, at least to our culture. So as I was reading about this, I found it so fascinating and really helped me to understand why my body, for example, actually feels much more tired, and it really burns me out to do a lot of heavy workouts. But if I do, you know, more regular, leisurely kind of workouts, I actually still get some really good results. So just how to balance things out. And I was trying to relay this information to friends and family around me, but was finding that our North American culture is not acclimated to this way of thinking. Part of just culturally, it's based on our language. Being a linguist, I can definitely see that. And just also over generations, like many of us have ancestors from the old countries, right? But the tradition gets lost. And especially as modern medicine came in, these what were considered not non-scientific medicine were pushed to the side. And I think what we are as a culture, we're starting to see more wisdom in traditional ways. We're not just pushing it under the rug or shoving it out as woo-woo stuff. We're starting to see and actually can prove it more with science too, even going into quantum physics especially, or having more sensitive equipment to measure the powers beyond nutrition in herbs, for example, that there's more to just what you can measure. currently, because anything that we can't explain right now, I mean, imagine a smartphone 20 years ago would look like magic, right? So just because we can't explain it doesn't mean that it's not worthy. So we're trying to get back on track. So body typing exists all over the world in different forms with different names. And I found it really, I couldn't relay this information with all the other names from other cultures. And so I just broke it down to the four elements: earth, fire, air, and water, which we can all relate to. And you use it as a metaphor, an analogy, to liken one thing to another. And so I use it in a form like the ancients use it to understand the body and your interaction with the environment that's going on around you. Did that answer your question with all those words?
Totally, yeah. And that's one of the things I loved about your book is that you brought up the point that the Greek humors started off being used medically, because a funny anecdote from my history, my mom, since I've known her, has been the manager of a doctor's office. So she hires people, and she would always give people a temperament quiz to figure out what temperament they were. And it was based off the four Greek what she called and what her books called temperament. So psychology picked up this method of characterization of people way before it was picked up by, well, re-picked up by healing methods here. And so once I got into nutrition and herbalism and I saw those Greek humors being used in a healing sense, I was like, oh my gosh, this isn't just like, this is your personality and this is your personality. Yeah. This can help you figure out what ailments you might be likely to get and how to stay in balance. This can help you figure out what foods keep you in balance and what foods keep you out of balance. This can help you figure out what herbs are going to work for you. So if two people have diabetes, but they have different temperaments or body types, but you give them both the same herb, they're not going to work for both of them, right? Because different things work for different people with different humors. And so it was like bringing my childhood back just in a totally different way of applying it. So it was super refreshing and exciting for me. So how can people figure out through Weight Free Wellness what body type they are, and then in what areas can this help them make better decisions to keep them in balance or stay out, or keep them in balance and stay out of imbalance?
I get that. Oh, I have to distinguish that. Saying that is challenging. In balance.
Yeah.
So I have created an online quiz that you can take. It's a simple, fun one. It's a much simpler version than the one that's in the book. The one in the book is quite thorough. And it's funny that you asked this, because I had someone email me just yesterday. She's like, you know, I started taking the quiz, but none of the answers were quite right. And so I stopped taking the quiz, just thought I'd let you know. I'm like, actually, thank you for giving me that feedback, because I had to simplify the quiz. Otherwise, no one would want to get through it. But what it does is, even by taking the quiz, you get a good idea of what body typing is about, which is really fun. And then I have a sequence of emails that educates you on the foods, the exercises, and the habits that help you to stay more balanced for each body type. And we're all a combination of there's earth, fire, air, and water. We're all a combination of the four of them, but we have a primary and a secondary that are most obvious to us and to others if they're observant in that way. And then I also do touch on the relationship aspect, which gets into the temperamental kind of humor aspect of the character types, the more personality types of the body types. So that's something that I want to write about and teach more about in the future. So it's definitely on my list of things that I want to get to. So currently I'm just working through the health and wellness aspect, the physical health and wellness, and also the mental emotional parts of that. And
so give us an example of how, just in the food realm, how, let's say between a fire type and a water type, how the same food, let's say dairy, might make one of those people feel amazing versus another one of those people feel horrible, and use that as an example to be like, oh, so we're not all supposed to be doing this standardized like diet and exercise recommendations.
That's a really good point. That, yes, absolutely, especially it can seem really confusing because there's so many diets out there these days, and I really am a proponent of finding out what works for you. And so a key component that to that is knowing your body type. And so you brought up a great example. So a fire type, if you imagine fire, okay, is typically hot. It can burn up fluids easily or make them evaporate. Fire tends to expand. It all depends on what kind of fuel is around it. But we can just pick up on those basic analogies, right? Water, it can be, it's usually, we think of it as in a liquid form. I think we all typically move into that realm. It's very, it adjusts to the container that it's in. So if it's in a river basin, it's going to look like a river. If it's in an ice cube tray and it's in the freezer, it's going to be solid and it's going to be in the shape of an ice cube. So those are, if it's a gas, it's going to be look like a cloud, or maybe we don't even see it. So those are a couple of examples. And so water type is very fluid, very malleable. They'll seem wishy-washy. There's our language correlates with it also. So if we look at dairy, dairy has more water tendencies. It you know, it's liquid. It has moisture to it. It also, because it's a liquid, goes in the shape of the container. So when we're talking about this, the concept of balance and imbalance, or being out of balance.
There we go.
Yes. To have balance, you need to have, imagine the scale, okay? The old fashioned kind of like the Liberty Justice scale, right? You need to have one thing to have balance. You need to have one thing that's of equal or close to equal weight, whatever that weight is, to the other side, so on the opposite side. Now, when we're talking about elements here, earth, fire, air, and water, fire and water are naturally on the opposite ends of the spectrum, just by their nature. One is very liquid. Liquid tends to be cool, but it's very reactive, so it can be warm too. But when it's warm, it changes. I'm trying to keep this simple, but it's hard. Keeps it simple. But the idea is, if on one end of the scale you have water and you add another thing that's like water to that end of the scale, it's going to throw it off balance. So if you dairy for a water type, typically will throw them off balance even more. But if you do the other example, you have dairy, which is very opposite, or water, which is very opposite from fire, because fire can burn up. It can use dairy, it can use liquid more, you're going to have more of a balance. So not to say that dairy is appropriate for all fire types, but their body constitution tends to be able to burn it up and use it more readily. And actually it can help them balance more, because as we know, water can put out a fire. So too much will put it out, but just enough, you can keep it under control.
Yeah, and I love that, because I think we are so, like you said, even just our language and our culture, we're so stuck in this one size fits all model. You have this symptom, you do this, they tell us to eat this, and unless I'm eating that, then I should feel guilty and be changing everything about my life, even though I feel fine. And so it's just really refreshing to see the embracement of our bio-individuality and our diversity. And just another story, because you brought up the relationship side of it. So I tend to be fire and air, which just, they exacerbate each other. And my husband is earth and water, which they exacerbate each other. So we have two combinations that throw ourselves out of balance. Yet when we put us together, we modulate each other. And so I'm laying in bed reading this book, just giggling about the descriptions of the earth and the water. I'm like, oh, that's so you. And then I get to the fire and air and I'm like, oh, that's so me. But then you can see how that's why we work so well together. Yet when we're not together, we can really get out of balance very quickly. So even in the area of wellness, I even think it can help you understand your relationships with not only yourself, but other people, because, I mean, it really does take a village to be whole. And so I really love all the applications of the body typings and how it just gets away from, like you said, weight as a metric of wellness. It's a weight-free kind of wellness. It's about this, how we show up in the world, not only with ourselves, but with others. And it was a really refreshing take on how to learn to love yourself and appreciate yourself and have compassion, not only with your body, but everyone else's body too, right?
Totally. Well, I'm glad to hear too that you enjoyed it. I know this is not necessarily a new topic to you. So that's always as wonderful to hear too.
Yeah, it was wonderful. It was great. So where can people go to either take that quiz or find the book if they want to dive into this and see how they can learn about their body type and start to become more in balance with themselves?
So the place to go is weightfreewellness.com. Of course, they'll find more podcasts like this as well, but they'll find the body typing quiz, which is a really great way to start. Or if you just want to dive right into the book is available there as well. I have, you can get a paperback, you can get a digital copy, and I also have audiobook available.
Awesome. I love that. Well, thank you so much for spending time with us today and waxing philosophical, but then also getting practical. And I really enjoyed diving into this topic with you.
I totally enjoyed it too. Thank you. I had a lot of fun.
Thanks. Have a great day.
You too. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you so much for listening to the Weight Free Wellness Podcast. Wasn't that a great first episode? You know, Lori and I have been corresponding lots and putting together this first class, and I'm so impressed in what she's putting together. It's really going to be a fun and very educational first class as well. So make sure to go to weightfreewellness.com and sign up for the first class that you'll get for free and hear about future classes with Lori. And thank you so much for listening. If you are loving this program, please share it with others. Just share it by social media, word of mouth. You can share right from your iTunes app and probably most apps on your phone if you're listening there. Give us a rating on iTunes or even on Facebook. Leave us a review. And we love hearing from you. We love interacting with you. So find us on your favorite social media platform and say, hey, have a great day, everybody. Bye-bye.